good morning. We're going to all practice our new sound for church today. On the count of three, go quack, okay? One, two, three. Quack. There you go. You scored. It's great to see you this morning. Are you glad for rain? Boy, we need that. We need that. It's a great thing to have some rain. It's good to see you. Hey, last Sunday morning, I was in Omaha, Nebraska, and I was online, ready to go, and I'm watching the clock on my phone, and worship started about 21 seconds late. And then I realized there's a 20-some second delay in the signal from here to there and thought, I thought I'd get him, but I didn't get to score. So, hey, it's good to see you this morning. Hope you're having a great day and you've had a great week. A couple of announcements I need to share. First of all, this Thursday, September the 2nd at 6 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall, there will be a new Bible study called Storming the Gates that's going to focus on giving you tools to share your faith. And we encourage you to come and be a part of that. If you want more information, see Carol Keller. She'll be glad to fill you in on all the details for that. And we just encourage you to come and be a part of that. Ladies, if you'll notice in the bulletin, on the right-hand side, the 2021 Kansas District Ladies Retreat is coming up in 1 month. And if you're interested in being a part of that, there are brochures out here in the East Foyer. And we encourage you to take a look at that and sign up if you're able to go. It'll be a great time together. Alabaster is quickly coming Sunday, September the 19th. If you haven't taken home an alabaster box yet, we're going to ask you to grab one if you can. And it's just a great opportunity to share out of our blessings for the ministry of the Church of the Nazarene. Now, you may ask this morning, what in the world is alabaster? And we would say this morning, we're glad you asked that. Watch this, and it'll start filling in the pieces.
In a small town, a group of 30 people meet to worship at an evening service. It's cold out, and the single room where they meet is heated by a small wood stove in the corner. There is only a little bit of room left by the time that everyone crowds in and has a seat. Worship songs are sung from sheets of paper passed around the room in the aid of a single guitar. When finished, they say a word of prayer, and the pastor brings a small wooden box to the front of the room that is shaped like a church building. He explains, "We have a tradition of giving what's called an alabaster offering together. It goes towards helping buy properties and buildings that are used for ministry all around the world. Sometimes it goes towards church buildings, sometimes schools or hospitals, and sometimes other properties that support missionary work. Basically, the alabaster offering is all of us chipping in with other churches for properties that are needed for the kingdom." When the offering is given, adults and children alike come up to drop their offerings through the small slot in the roof of the box. The kids are excited to drop the small coins that they have been saving for the occasion and like to hear the sound that it makes. The pastor prays that God would bless this offering to the building of the kingdom around the world. Months go by, the weather turns warmer, and the meetings carry on as they had. One Sunday, the pastor preaches about the power of prayer, and towards the end of the service, he reaches behind the makeshift pulpit and gets out the small box. He says, "Now I want to encourage you. Do you remember when we gave an offering in the box last winter and prayed that it would go towards God's work around the world? Well, it did. Our alabaster offering, along with the offering of many other churches, has gone towards a new church building in Botswana, Africa. Our prayer was answered, and so was the prayer of the church that is going to be using that building. I think it's great that we were a part of that. And there's something else. This might be upsetting to some of you that have grown attached to meeting here, but we aren't going to be meeting here much longer. You see, our district superintendent called me last week and let me know that our church is going to be receiving alabaster funds to purchase a place of our own. It won't be long before we're in a place with some room to grow.
God said amen, all right? encourage you to be a part of Alabaster. Our church has benefited not from the Alabaster, but from our teens serving. All of the landscape or the grass around our building was started by a teen mission group that came and ripped out all the old stuff. You guys remember that? Remember the mud going, when are we going to finish that project? Well, that's one thing I've noticed about churches. It takes a while to finish projects, but we get them done. We get them done. So are you ready to worship? Why don't you stand? We're going to read out of James chapter 1. It says, whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts shifting shadows. He chose to give birth to us by giving us his true word. And we, out of all creation, became his prized possession. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness of God, that God desires. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word God has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey, it's like glancing at your face in the mirror. You see yourself and walk away and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you came to be religious but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself, for your religion is worthless. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. Amen. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Our first song this morning talks about how we're not going to stop. And let that follow right in with the scripture that we heard. We are not going to stop listening. We're not going to stop doing. Because if you just listen but don't do, that's a problem also, right? You got to hear it and then go act on it, okay? So we're not going to stop. Amen? Let's sing out this morning. I give you glory for all you brought me through, and now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow after you, and now I'm ready for whatever. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before.
Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
I know the breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know the breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know a breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
Is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before.
All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. God is for me. He's not against me. I will hold to the plans he has for me. When I'm broken, he will fix me. I will call on the name of the Lord.
All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
He's my heart song in my sorrow. He's my hope and my strength for tomorrow. When the storms rise all around me, I will
to my soul.
Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
I got joy, joy.
Thank you.
soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go.
Amen. Amen.
I love when we sing that song because these guys have so much fun doing it, you know? We get to just sit and like watch. It's cool to see the smiles and the joy. No, I sat and watched, you know. I got to worship and celebrate just seeing God move your souls. That was cool. That's cool stuff. Hey, God is good, amen?
Amen.
I just want to share a word of praise from our family this week. It's a prayer request as well. We've had an interesting week in our family. On Wednesday, Caitlin and two of her coworkers were attacked at work. And it was a really ugly situation. The three gals all wound up in the emergency room. Caitlin got the worst of it and has suffered a severe, severe concussion. Lots of bruising, lots of other stuff, and she really needs your prayers. Her coworkers are doing a little better, but we just appreciate your prayers. You know, when we ask the Lord to just protect our loved ones, I don't know if you do that often, but I do it every day. In the conversations that we had this week with Caitlin and her coworkers, one of them said that had Caitlin not come into the room when it happened, the first girl probably would have had her life taken. And Caitlin wound up getting the worst of it, and she said, better me than them, and I loved her spirit about that, but at the same time, she's pretty messed up, so we just appreciate your prayers for her this week, that God would be with her back to the doctor tomorrow, and praying that God will just work in her heart and life and bring healing. It's kind of tough to deal with that. We have another huge prayer request this morning. Sharon's brother, Steve, and his wife down in Tulsa have been battling COVID. Her brother, Steve, is in the hospital in Tulsa, has been there for a couple of weeks, is on a ventilator. He's stable, but in critical condition, and we just want to pray that God would be with them in a very special, special way, and be with Stan and Sharon as well. They're extremely close as a family, and this is a tough time. Lots of folks are struggling with COVID again right now, and we just encourage you to be safe, hand washing, all those things that we do to keep ourselves safe and free from illness, but we want to pray especially today for the Conrads down in Tulsa. You might also this week, if you have a chance, send a text message to Pastor James and say, hey, old man, how are you? Because he's now a grandpa, and he's wearing the title well. He has a beautiful new little granddaughter, and they're excited about that. And Angie has gotten to spend part of the week there. James doesn't get to see the baby till tonight, so he's kind of feeling left out. But if you need his phone number, just see me. I'll give it to you, and you can just blow his phone up with text this week and say, hey, old man. It's always good for grandpas to hear that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, you are so good, and I just thank you today for being with us and for the way that, God, you so abundantly provide for us. Lord, this morning as the rain began to come down, I just thought, God, this is a blessing from heaven. We've needed it so badly, and on the Lord's day, we're just thankful that you brought it to us, and we don't know how much we've got or if it's going to keep raining, but every little bit is something we praise you for, and I just want to do that this morning and say thank you. Father, you're so good to us. There is not one in this room who could not share a testimony of your presence, your work, how you've been so near to them in their lives. And God, I just pray this morning that from the bottom of our hearts, you would hear us all say a collective thank you. Your grace is sufficient. Your spirit is ever present. Your protection is complete. And God, for being so near, we just want to give you the praise and say thank you. Father, as we pray this morning, we lift those needs that I've mentioned as well as those that go unmentioned this morning. All of us have things in our lives, people, situations, circumstances, where we just need your grace and guidance, where we need an outpouring of your love and your power, where healing needs to happen. So many different needs, God. We just pray that you would be Lord over all and Lord in all, and Lord through all. Be especially today with Sharon's brother Steve and his wife. God, today they both need a touch from your hand. I'm thankful that you are the Lord, our healer, Jehovah Rapha. And I pray, God, that you'd go across the miles to Tulsa and that today you would touch both of them with your healing hand. Be with Steve there in intensive care as he's struggling and having to deal with a ventilator and all of those things, God, in his battle with COVID. God, we just pray that right now you would come near and you would touch him. And you would touch her as well, that they both could know your presence today. Thank you, Lord, that they belong to you and that they can pray and we can pray for them, knowing that God is your children. You will hear and answer our prayers. So we pray healing over them today. God, I also pray for Caitlin and her co-workers today and that whole situation. I pray, God, healing and grace and strength for all three of these ladies. That, God, you would just be to them and for them and in them everything that they need you to be. I pray especially for Caitlin, who suffered the most significant injuries, that, God, you would bring healing, that you would clear up all the effects, God, of the concussion, and that you, God, would just watch over and keep her in the hollow of your hand. Father, we're so thankful that you are a God who loves us the way you do. This morning, we want to love you back. And as we do that, God, I just pray that you would take everything that we are and receive it, Lord, as an offering of love and worship to you. Hear now those words that you taught us to pray, as together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. The lost, to redeem a whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died. Praise the you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good. For the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth alone shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings, praise forever to the King. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, and we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, and we live for you. And we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Yeah. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, and we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will
beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Pastor, come.
Well, it's good to be back with you this morning and have the opportunity to share with you again today from the Word of the Lord. I don't normally advertise my Sunday night messages, but we just recently finished a series in 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. And tonight, and I don't really believe I'm saying this, but the Lord said I had to, so I'm gonna. We're launching into a new series in light of things in the world as they are today, and beginning this evening, I'm gonna be preaching a new series out of the book of Revelation. And those of you who have studied with me on Wednesday nights know that sometimes when we go through books of the Bible, it kind of gets long. And the last time I taught Revelation, it took 18 months. And if it takes that long to preach through it, there's a little difference between teaching it and preaching through it. I won't have to worry about my sermon series on Sunday nights for the next 18 months. Praise the Lord. I'll know where I'm headed and you can get over it. So starting tonight, we're going to take a look at the book of Revelation and start working our way through. And just encourage you to come and be a part of that with us at 6 o'clock on Sunday nights. And we'll see what the Lord, Word of the Lord has to say to us there. 6 weeks ago, I began a series in sharing with you on Sunday morning the core components of what it means to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ. And in the midst of sharing that series with you, I've shared now, this will be my fifth message in that series. And it's been kind of fun for me in this process to realize that in the midst of sharing our faith, in the midst of communicating the good news of the gospel to those around us, once we get them saved, we have to do something with them. And I'm currently teaching in the School of Ministry right now, organic outreach. And we've been talking a lot about reaching lost and broken people for the Lord. And my students are like, you know, this is great stuff, but what happens when we get them saved? And that's what this series has been all about. What does it mean to be a disciple of the Lord? Jesus introduced us to this whole concept of discipleship when in Matthew's gospel, right on the heels of his temptation at the hands of Satan and his triumphant victory over Satan there, he begins journeying, and as he travels down along the seashore one day, he sees some men in a boat fishing, and he looks at them and says, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Now, at the outset, what they heard from this teacher, probably, you know, it wasn't really that big of a deal. By the way he was dressed, they probably assumed he was a rabbi. By the way he spoke, they probably assumed that he was inviting them to a new level of study and discussion and involvement in the growth of faith. But we, having hindsight, they didn't have, we understood it meant so much more than that. Those whom he called in the subsequent years, with the exception of one or two, would all give their lives for the gospel. They would die as martyrs for the faith. Discipleship took on a very serious nature for them. We're living in a day and age when, if you look on the world scene, being a disciple of Jesus Christ is becoming increasingly more and more difficult. Here in the United States, we don't really get our feathers too ruffled because for us, we don't have a clue what it is to be persecuted. Oh, we like to think we do when somebody calls us out for our faith, or they tell us we can't pray in school, or we can't read scripture. We think that is persecution. But on the world scene, persecution's really different. Lives are taken every day because they name the name of Jesus. Families are torn asunder. Horrible things happen because they embrace Jesus. And the call to discipleship today is probably one of the most significant calls outside of our nation that anyone could ever have. And my prayer is that in these days, when things are changing rapidly, that we would understand how serious this call is as well. That to be called Christian is really a badge of honor, because today we are called to reflect the name and the life of Jesus Christ. In talking about what it meant to be a disciple, I've shared with you a number of things over the last few weeks. And you might be asking, Pastor, why in the world do you keep reviewing this? And by the end of the message today, you're going to get it, I promise you. But it's important for you to hear again the steps we've taken on this discipleship journey. We began by talking about the fact that a disciple is someone who's chosen to follow Jesus, who is being changed by Jesus from the inside out, and who's committed to the mission and the ministry of Jesus in their everyday life. But we've also talked about the fact that a disciple is someone who has chosen to live their life for Jesus. They've entered into relationship. They've accepted the assignment to follow him and become fishers of men. They know what it is to walk with Jesus. We've also talked about the fact that to be a true disciple of Jesus, you have to live your life loving like Jesus loved. Now that's easy when everybody's lovable. That's really easy when everybody's lovable. But when they're not so lovable, it's a little tougher. And every one of us has people in our lives, whether we would admit it or not, that just aren't the most lovable creatures in the world. And Jesus calls us to love them as followers of his anyway. Don't look at your spouse, as some of you are doing right now. We've also talked about the fact that in the life of a disciple, obedience means doing what is right, not just expedient, regardless of the circumstances or situation. Let me just kind of hammer that one just a little bit. There are lots of times in our lives when we have opportunities to make decisions. Some of those decisions, we would be tempted to take the path of least resistance just so that it doesn't ruffle anybody's feathers or cause anybody concern or problems, so that we might get away with it without getting scarred. But here's the reality. If that choice is just to do what's expedient, not what's right, it's the wrong choice. God says to us through his Son and through the Word that if we love him, we will do what he says. And that means we walk in obedience to him all the time. Well, this morning I want to share one final step in this process that kind of pulls it all together and makes it all fit. And it's found this morning in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Verses that are probably familiar to you. If not, you can turn there and follow along with you. I want to read them to you this morning from the New American Standard Bible. Just some great words from the pen of Paul. He says, "Therefore, I urge you by the mercies of God to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect." What we're going to talk about today and what is at the heart of this message is the understanding that we live in a world today that's trying to make us look like it. I love what J.B. Phillips shared in his paraphrase when he tried to help us understand the depth of Romans chapter 12, verse 2, and said, "Don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold." I can get my hands on that. I don't understand that. Don't allow the world around you to create in you a desire for stinking thinking, to say that I'm just going to embrace the ways and the hatred and the heartache and the brokenness of the world as a normal way of life, because after all, that's what everybody's doing. But I want you to understand that's not what a disciple does. When we read the words of Paul in Romans, there's a constant awareness that he's saying to us there's a difference between living life in this present age and living life for the age that is to come. Now, we'd like to think that age is still out there, that we're all still moving towards some great moment when Jesus comes again and receives us to himself and does away with this broken world order. And while that will happen one day, I'd like to submit to you that Paul isn't saying that. He's saying, don't give in to the ways of the world now, but recognize that future age, that moment when Jesus will set up his kingdom on earth, has already begun in you. You see, his work in your heart is a reflection of what he will complete in your life in that day when we all go to see Jesus. As believers, we're to live in the world but not be of it. And that's what lies at the heart of these verses that I think really talk about holiness and surrender. R.N. Longenecker writes that this teaching holds that believers in Jesus are to live their lives in the context of the age to come, with this distinctive power for righteous living, which has been inaugurated by Jesus' earthly ministry, his death, his resurrection. But we live that in the context of this present age, with all of its negative powers and all the stuff that happens around us, with God expecting us to be different. So are you? In the world in which we live, are you different than the world in which we live? Paul makes the statement that we're to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. I love that word, transformation. It comes from the Greek word metamorphosis, and it talks about that incredible thing that happens when God begins to work within. He takes everything that is and transforms it into what he desires it to be. And the result is this renewal of our mind, this renewal of the way that we live our lives, this transformation that says we will be in the world but not of the world. We will reflect Jesus in all things. He says to us over and over and over again in this passage that we're to live by the mercies of God in a manner where we present ourselves to him as living and holy sacrifices. Now, I don't know about you, but that's pretty big imagery. You think about the Old Testament, the sacrificial system was a pretty gruesome thing. They say that when Jesus came to Jerusalem, the week that he died, it was that time in the season when the Jewish people had gathered for sacrifice. They estimate that that week, somewhere between 250,000 and 500,000 lambs would have been sacrificed on the altar in the temple. We were there a number of years ago, and under the altar there that is now an Islamic shrine, there is this incredible cavern, and you can see fissures in the rocks when you're down in that cavern where the blood would flow and pool underneath and then through more fissures out through the rocks of the eastern wall of the great city of Jerusalem. When Jesus came down and entered into the city, he would see the blood coursing down into the Kidron Valley, and he would know that soon he would be the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So when Paul begins to talk about sacrifice, about offering ourselves as a sacrifice, as a spiritual service of worship to the Lord, he's cutting quick at the hearts of those of the Jewish faith and those who surrounded the Jewish faith and giving them an image that said discipleship is tough and is hard and will demand your all. At the heart of these two incredible verses this morning is a simple call to total surrender. A call that results in a life of holiness that reflects the plans and the purposes of God in every single one of us. Now, what I want to do this morning is walk through a number of questions. They're all going to lead to a summation at the end. And as we walk through these, I want you to think with me, because as we make this journey, there is this realization that God wants to do a continuing new thing in us. Here's the first question. What in the world does it mean to present yourself as a living sacrifice? Tough question. I think at its core, it means that we're called to surrender our all to him, and in doing so, to reflect in our attitudes and in our thoughts and in our actions the fullness and the completeness of Christ within. When we present ourselves as living sacrifices, we're saying that once we were dead, but now we're alive. Once we were blind, but now we see. Once we were lost in our sin and all of its penalty, but now by the grace of God, we've been made new and have been forgiven and set free from sin's dominion. We are living sacrifices, never to die again. We're called to surrender our all to him and to recognize that when Paul talks about the body in verse 1, that we would make of our body a living sacrifice, he's talking about the totality of our being. That this morning, everything that you are, you and I are to offer to the Lord as a beautiful sacrifice of worship. I love the way N.T. Wright puts it. He's just a great commentator. I love to read. He says, Christian living never begins with a set of rules. though it contains them as it goes forward. It begins in the glad offering of one's whole self to God, whose mercy has come all the way to meet us in our rebellion and in our sin and in our death. And within that, it involves the renewal of our mind so that we're enabled to both think straight and act accordingly. I think what he's trying to say when he says present ourselves as living sacrifices is he just saying be holy as he is holy and live that life every moment of every day in a world that is broken and filled with sin. So what's that involve? What's involved in this act of surrender and the transformation and the renewal that Paul talks about in Romans 12, 2? I think, first of all, while God desires that we be a holy people, he wants us to understand that holiness of heart and life, the pathway to holiness, is really an individual experience and a result of growth in grace. One of our core values in the Church of the Nazarene is a statement that says, we are holy. And we believe that as a people, we're called to be a holy people who live our lives before a holy God in an unholy world. And there is this tendency, there is this temptation to say that if you're one of us, you will be holy. But there are times we know we don't measure up. And we kind of struggle to hang out with the folks who do because we don't want to be embarrassed. I want you to understand this morning that holiness is an individual experience. And while corporately we say it's something we embrace, the reality is we all get there one step at a time at a speed for us that's determined not by the church or anybody else, but by God alone. We all grow at different paces. I would love to be that person who always figures it out, who's always at the front of the line saying, I got this. But there are a lot of times I just have to sit back and realize that I'm not as smart as I thought I was. And I'm going to have to grow into some of these things a little bit slower. And I love that old acrostic. It begins with B, and it's just the first letters of all the phrase, be patient with me, God isn't finished with me yet. I love that truth. Because we're still on the grow. Paul, I think, also wants us to understand that this act of surrender is in reality a spiritual act of worship. I've never really thought about of holiness in these terms until recently, when I came to the understanding that when I give myself to the Lord, not out of compulsion or force, but in response to all of the mercies that he's poured into me, it really is an act of worship. To be holy isn't just a lifestyle, it's a worship experience. To say that I embrace all things God isn't just a statement about how I live my life, but rather a statement of how I worship him. That in everything I put him first. And understand very clearly that as I live my life daily for him, it really is an act of worship. When was the last time you got up in the morning and said, today I'm going to live my life actively worshiping him? Because that's what it is. Your first breath in the morning is an act of worship. where we celebrate the fact that he has given us breath, and with breath, life, and the joy that comes with living. And this act of worship should never be done for what you get out of it, but rather for what you give. Your total self in devotion and love for God. I'd like to think that if I worship God right, I get to celebrate the fact that one day I get to go to heaven. And I do. But if that is my sole motivation in worshiping him, I've missed everything his word tries to teach us. It's not about what we get. It's about what we're blessed to give. I have an incredible staff here at the church. They each bring something unique to the team. I've not really figured out my part yet, but Dawn brings to us this sense of organization. She has a way of making the chaos we create something that can actually become something. It's kind of a unique thing. John, I think his biggest struggle in life is figuring out where I'm at and what I'm doing. But he brings this sense of order to all things around here and how it all pulls together. I got a new gal on the staff, Miss Julie. I told her the other day, and I meant it with all my heart, and I'll say it again today, she brings absolute joy to our staff. On her worst day, she still smiles. I love that, because on my worst day, I crab, and I'm grouchy, and I usually get told to go to my office and stay there. Julie walks in and, good morning. Good morning. And I just love her for it. We come to this realization that it's what we bring to the field, what we offer to his kingdom, that is a reflection of our worship of him. The contagious smile, the joyful statements, the organization, all that stuff we all bring, it's all an act of worship. Dennis Kinlaw, former president of Asbury Seminary and pastor there, said, the believer offers himself or herself to God, not so much for what can be gained, but rather as an expression of pure devotion in view of God's mercy, which has already been experienced. In other words, I just love to offer myself to God because of what he's done for me. And if I look at the way I live my life in that context, it changes the way I live. Because I realize apart from him, I'm nothing. So how do we go about offering ourselves as an act of worship to the Lord? And what does it entail? Well, I told you at the start, I've been having you review with me every week on purpose. Let me answer this question by sharing what I've shared. How do we go about this offering of ourselves as an act of worship to the Lord? And what does it entail? Well, it begins when we choose to follow God, to follow Jesus with all of our hearts, to allow him to change us from the inside out, to transform us into his image as we commit ourselves to his mission and his ministry on a daily basis. Romans 12, 1 and 2 lived out looks like that. I choose Jesus. And I'm going to allow him to do whatever he wants to do in me. That's that renewing of the mind. And I'm going to do it because I want to be able to express his will, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. There's another step, though, in that process. And when we try to understand how we go about offering ourselves as an act of worship to the Lord, we recognize that it continues when, having chosen to follow Jesus, we make it our life passion to live for him without reservation, to walk in relationship with him every moment of every day, to rise in the morning and to lay our heads down at night saying, I choose Jesus, God first in all things. That's what it means to offer yourself as an act of worship. Paul goes on. And as he talks about this whole thing, there's this next little piece that when we ask the question, how do we offer ourselves as an act of worship, we grow and we commit ourselves to the great commandment. And loving God supremely and as our neighbors as ourselves, just as Jesus modeled for us. I did a funeral yesterday up in Bennington. I didn't know the lady. I got to know about her through her family. She lived with a vivacious spirit. She was loving and caring. She was one of those kind of people who put a smile on your face. In the midst of getting ready to do the service, State trooper walked up to me, and it was a man by the name of Jason DeVore. Some of you know who Jason is, and he was a dear friend of Fred Dotterman's, and he and I began to talk and reminisce and share, and he made a statement that I grabbed hold of. As we talked about Fred, he said, we were blessed to have been loved by a man just like Jesus. And that's what he calls us to do. And when I offer myself as a sacrifice of worship, I'm saying, Jesus, I'm going to love, whether I feel like it or not, just like you did. In a lost and broken world. How do we go about offering ourselves an act of worship? Well, we learn that it means to walk in obedience to him. Always doing what is right, not expedient, regardless of the circumstance or situation. I'd like to tell you that obedience is always easy. Have you figured out that it isn't? That sometimes doing the right thing is costly and hurts and is hard? I was reading this week in my devotions, Matthew chapter 6. I was going through the Lord's Prayer, as we call it. I got down to that verse where, having taught us how to pray, he then gives his comment and he says, basically, if we forgive, we'll be forgiven. If we don't, we won't. Now, I read that this week on the heels of a phone call from my daughter saying, I just got attacked at work. I'm okay. I'm going to the emergency room. I don't know if you ever had a phone call like that, but your daddy mode kicks in a really ugly way. And the first thought that I had, I wished I could tell you it was a Jesus thought, but it wasn't. I don't want to catch that person who laid hands on my daughter. That's my first thought. I just had this ugly moment. And all I wanted to do was just go and say, "Egh!" And then she made this statement. "Daddy, it's okay. He didn't know what he was doing." I hate it when my kids write. And I stopped and I said, "God, I can't do anything now except to forgive and be there and love and do what you'd have me to do." And a tragedy became an act of worship, whether I felt like it or not. And having done all those things, I learned that we choose to worship him by giving him absolute control of every part of our lives as an act of worship, reflecting him and his holiness in the way that we live our everyday lives. I just have to be Jesus, whether I feel like it or not, because my life is what I offer to him. So in the end, what is this heart holiness supposed to look like? Well, let me wrap it up by asking you to look very closely at Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. It begins when we understand that we present ourselves as living and holy sacrifices to God. The goal of discipleship is that we get this right here. My life is to be lived as a holy sacrifice to him. In living that life, I make the decision willfully. I choose not to let the world squeeze me into its mold. The world we live in right now is not a nice place. What we have seen happen in the last couple of weeks in Afghanistan has left a lot of U.S. veterans ashamed of the fact that they ever wore the uniform, and has caused heartache and grief in unparalleled dimensions for families around the world. And it's come home to us. It has. Week and a half, we're going to remember September 11th. As a nation, we'll relive that horror. And the temptation will be for us to be squeezed into the mold of our world with anger and hatred and venom and judgment. But what would happen if instead of letting the world squeeze us into its mold, we embraced the words of Jesus, who said to those who had placed him on the cross, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Don't let this world squeeze you into its mold. This heart holiness says we allow God to renew our minds by the transforming work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I'm so glad I don't have to figure this out. And when I just release myself to Him as an act of worship, He is free to work in me and do what needs to be done to make me into the person He's called me and desires me to be. And then we prove through our lives, as we live them for the Lord, what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. I urge you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. That happens when we say, as the old song does, I surrender all. Which leaves us this morning with a crowding question. Are you fully surrendered to Him? We began in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 9 in a simple verse that said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. If you read just a little further into verse 20, there's an interesting thing that happens. It says, immediately they left their nets and followed Him. That's what it means to be fully surrendered. Immediately. Not when we get around to it, feel like it, or get to the place where we think, I can do it now. I've done what I want to do long enough. Immediately. Right now. Are you fully surrendered to Him? Father God, I pray this morning that you'd search my heart. My sole desire is to be a disciple of your Son's. And I realize that you teach us in your word that when a disciple is fully taught, he'll be like his teacher. And that means if I'm going to be a disciple, I have to reflect Jesus in my everything. So search me today, God. And if there's any part of me, God, that has not surrendered, that has not said all to Jesus, I surrender all, would you help me right now just to let go of that? And falling into the arms of my Savior, make my life a living sacrifice, lived wholly and purposely for Him. And God, what I pray for myself, I pray also for my people this morning, those worshiping here and those online with us, that we could all just ask you, God, that crowning question, are we fully surrendered to you? And with full, without, and if we don't have full assurance of faith in our answer, that you would just help us right now to say, okay, God, I'm yours. And may it be said of us that we truly are your disciples. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. Enjoy Sunday school and come back and we'll dive into Revelation tonight. God bless.